Pleasure to have you here.
Happy to be here.
All right.
K. Tim.
Do you go by Snakefinger with your friends, or should we call you Philip?
No, call me Snakefinger. That's okay. What everyone calls
Where'd
me.
Where'd you get that nickname? Or is that perhaps a professional name?
No, it happened a long time ago, but actually here in California, when I was playing at a place in Eureka with the residents and the legendary Ensenada.
Yes, Ensenada.
Who you might have heard of.
We've heard of the residents and Ensenada and you, but not very many people seem to know very much about you or actually have met you. In fact, the residents, of course, we see them with their eyeball heads on, but beyond that, I suppose you being one of their sidemen and contributors to a lot of their works, know more about the... Well, let's start at the top. There's a very interesting group of companies over in San Francisco on Grove Street, the Crypto Corporation, Ralph Records, and all the people who contribute to them. Now that's MX80 and Tuxedo Moon. And,
good God, you're very well informed.
And you, the residents, of course, and there must be someone else.
The Art Bears.
Yeah, and... Is Fripp on Ralph?
Well, he comes and visits. He's not actually on the label.
Well, if we were to talk about the corporation as a whole, because it seems that the label and the management corporation, everyone is a contributing factor to everyone else's well-being and artistic future.
Yeah.
Could you give us a short biography of Ralph Records and how you came to meet the boys over there?
Well, I met the boys, as it were, through, if you can call them, giant eyeballs boys. Maybe they're girls, who knows?
Yeah, conceivably.
But I met them through Ensenada. I was on a cycling trip of Austria in my youth, and he insisted that I come to California and meet these chaps who were as yet to be the residents. And we met up with them in San Mateo and did our first recording together, which came out on a tape called Baby Sex, which was rather... I perhaps ought not go any further into that.
This is
the radio, and there are a lot of people listening.
Then Roman Polanski's not.
Really, yeah, he's out of the country at the moment. But that's generally how I met them, in San Mateo, back in 1971, which was when we first got together.
So I see you were born in London in 1949, and...
Good grief, don't give that kind of thing away.
We're getting less and less cryptic as we go on, that's right. And I think I'll just put this bio down, because I don't want to know too much about that. But let's talk about your early career in London, when you first played guitar.
Well, blues was my, guiding light. It's what I loved, and it's what I still love, and what I still listen to. People back in the 50s and 60s, James Brown, and... the old blues people. I mean,
sure.
That's where I got my main musical influences.
And the residents, where they got their main influences is a mystery to me, but we have most of the records here, I think, and I wouldn't want to call it rock and roll, or even new wave, or progressive music. It's something entirely different.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's completely different, and it's yet to be classified as anything in particular.
Most assuredly.
Which, likewise myself, I don't think I'm fashionable because... I'm so out of touch with what's going on. A lot of my influences come from what I read and what I see on films as opposed to what I hear in music. There are very few people that I consider worth listening to. No offense to the listening public or the playing public.
A lot of people feel the same way. It's harder and harder for people to find a radio station to listen to, much less be able to find the records that they, feel comfortable with at home for
Absolutely.
Their own private listening.
Yeah.
Modern music, one of the problems we have here at KTEM, because we're a progressive station and don't have a format, is riding the fence between the rock hits of the 50s and 60s and 70s, and then trying to find out what the hits of the 70s or late 70s and 80s are going to be, and how to one, satisfy everyone's musical taste, and then at the same time challenge them and show them what the future's going to be.
And I don't think jumping into the so-called new wave is the answer either. I mean, it's been tried and it's failed through many obvious reasons, in that the new wave isn't particularly new. It was a great idea and a kick in the behind to a lot of people, and it generally got the energy moving as it should have done, but what it produced wasn't what it should have produced, which is new music and new ideas. And this is what we're trying to do here, new ideas, new music.
Excellent. So you're a resident of San Francisco now, aren't you?
I'm living here now.
I
think it's a fabulous place as opposed to a lot of my new wave contemporaries in England who say are bored with the USA.
Yeah, but this is one of the few places where the Clash's record is selling, so...
Absolutely.
How bored can you be when they keep flying you over here?
I dig it.
Your new record, which is called Chewing Hides the Sound on Ralph Records, is my first experience with you as a solo artist. Is this your first solo album?
It's my first solo album and my first new album. I was in LA for 2 years after being in a relatively successful English band called the Chilly Willies.
Right.
I had to have a 2-year think in LA as to what does a rock musician do who begins to hate rock music. My career, and I despise everything it stands for, you know. So it basically needed a rethink, and I rethought.
Did you stop playing during those 2 years?
Absolutely. I played very little. I had a little play with Little Feat, who I particularly liked at the time.
Good place for a slide guitarist.
Absolutely, absolutely, the absolute best, you know. And a few people, you know, in the sort of country and blues realms down there, and played a few coffee house type gigs on my own.
Mm-hmm.
But I might as well have been in the Fish Finger Factory, basically. I was biding my time and thinking, you know, what's next? Something new has got to happen because I can't continue going on in this level.
So this was before your cycling trip with Ensenada up north?
No, this was well after.
Oh, well.
I'd already met the residents and left the residents to go back and play in bands in England. And I'd always kept in contact with the residents, and sometimes they'd send me a tape just to play guitar on, and which they'd put into their music. And
you'd add the track and send it back?
Absolutely, oh, yeah. I'd just play music and they'd put it on. They were loose enough at the time. Now they're becoming a lot more structured and generally a lot more tight in their music. But their ideas are still flowing incredibly in advance of anybody else I know or I've even heard of.
I don't want to ask you their names, that's not really important, but were the residents musicians like yourself that became disenchanted with what they thought was the future of rock or popular music, or were...
Well, not really. They come from a completely different place. They come from a place that says that anybody can do it. And, I mean, there are geniuses within the residents, as you probably have sussed out, you know. I mean, some of them are clever beyond their time, beyond their years, and well in advance of anything else, you know. So for them, they're not musicians as such, but they just say, why not be musicians? And with that attitude, they go in and play as well as any musicians I know. And their ideas are so wonderful, you know, that's what makes them truly interesting.
They write a lot of nice Christmas songs, too. It's now, here it is, almost December, so we'll be playing Santa Dog soon again. That was one of the big requests last Christmas. Seriously, it was. It's a little hard to actually talk about the kind of music we're discussing, so let's play a cut from your album, give our audience a chance to figure it out, and give me a chance to come up with some new questions for new music. Snake Fingers, our guest today at KTIM, and that's called The Model from his latest album, entitled Chewing Hides the Sound. We were just talking about... Well, it's impossible in 1979, this time, to escape the future of music, and no one seems to know where modern music is going. But I'd like to backtrack, take you back to your days in Los Angeles when you stopped playing music. I was a musician for a while, for about 5 years, and I remember when I stopped playing it, but I stopped playing it. Now look what I'm doing, see? But what made you begin again and in such a different vein? What gave you the... there has to be some pleasure in what you do as a musician.
Absolutely.
That daily pleasure.
I was in a really bad predicament my whole career, ever since I was, you know, 12 or 13. I mean, I knew I wanted to play. I knew it was rock music. I also knew that James Brown had done James Brown as well as James Brown could ever be done. All those people, they'd done it as well as it could be done. Just repeating it and trying to do it again, I mean... No way. Why should you want to play second best? If your whole career is developed to be being the absolute best. I basically wanted a field that nobody else was in at all. My idea about music is that experiments come when the popular music gets decadent. As in, with swing music, it was getting decadent in the 50s. It had had its huge influence in the 30s and 40s, and it was really wonderful. Towards the 50s, it was getting decadent, boring, and awful, kind of what's happening to pop music nowadays. Mm-hmm. And suddenly rock and roll appeared with its roots in that very same swing music, only taking it much further, taking it somewhere new and interesting and exciting. And the first experiment sounded crude and a bit hard to listen to. And I mean, you know, you've listened to old rock music.
Oh, yeah.
And I feel the same way about what I'm doing, you know. I mean, it's crude, and I'm experimenting, and I'm trying new things. But basically, I'm taking the roots of the last thing, which is rock and roll and rock music, as you know, and taking it and advancing it and taking it out into the future and changing it. And I refuse to play the field with the rest of the horses, as it were.
Or sometimes the rest of the whores. Said. Well, you know what John Barrymore said, there's nothing wrong with being a young whore, but there's nothing uglier than an old whore. So,
absolutely.
He discovered himself to be an old whore, and it couldn't do anything but, you know, he was doing radio to pay for his booze, and it took a very long time to kill himself that way.
Well, that's absolutely the right attitude. I take the attitude of Robert Graves that says that, you know, what I'm meant to be doing is invoking the muse, you know, not bringing down the government. And that's what I'm trying to do, invoke the muse of a new age, a new era. And it might be very crude and very experimental and not easy listening to start off with. And I can guarantee it won't be any easier as it gets on. It'll only be harder.
The experiments become more difficult.
The experiments become more difficult, more further out, and you drop the roots that make people comfortable.
Yeah. Well, the Cryptic Corporation and Ralph Records have done that successfully. My first experience listening to that music was, I had to leave it on. It was almost like the first time you listen to reggae music or black music, if you've never heard, you know, true soul music before.
Absolutely.
You can't listen to one cut. You have to let the atmosphere take over. And
absolutely.
That's something that you guys have developed. When I say you guys, I mean Ralph Records in general has cultivated a cult audience, a small audience. And I see your ads in English publications, Trouser Press, and some of the...
Even need I say it? Rolling Stone.
My God, well, I haven't seen that.
Lord.
I haven't read that lately.
Good grief, how decadent can we get?
Yeah, well, we're part of the backwater that they left when they went to New York, so it's only fair that they advertise now. What is your audience? Who are the people buying Ralph Records and listening to the residents? Do you have your pulse on your public? Or pulse of
pretty
the public?
Pretty much. What we figure, well, I can only speak for myself. I'm not a representative of Ralph, you know. I've always figured that there's 5% of the world who is an evolutionary throw forward, if you like. There's always 5% moving further on than the rest. The rest always eventually follow suit. And I figure that the pulse at the moment is on the 5%. The people listening to Ralph Records are the 5% who are moving forward, who everyone else will take their lead from eventually. But as opposed to the residents, from my point of view, the residents... There's no point in me doing what the residents are doing because they're already there doing it. As far as I'm concerned, they've gone much further out than most people are prepared to undertake or to understand. I mean, the people like you and myself and, you know, various 5% of the listeners out there who we're talking to, they will dig it, they'll get on it and understand it and appreciate it. But for the rest of the world, it's completely out of the question to even consider it. So basically, what I came to, my conclusion in LA, was that there needed to be a stepping stone in between where rock is today, the newest rock, and where the residents are. Because the residents haven't left anything to hold on to for those people. They're further out. If you've listened to Eskimo,
yes,
it's practically not music at all. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, it's an absolute masterpiece. And maybe one of the most important records of the decade. I would say without doubt it is. But my point of view is to give the roots to the people that need the roots to hold on to grasp the music. And that's what I'm doing, giving the roots and taking them further out and leading them along, leading them perhaps eventually to the residents and beyond. But at the moment, that's where I'm going.
Well, let's compare you for a moment to, say, something really, really, let's compare you to a foreigner. There's somebody who's trying to sell records to the FM audience. They're also trying to have AM hits. They're trying to tour the big, you know, stadiums like Oakland during the summer. And they've sold a lot of records. So when they sit down to write a song, they're thinking of all those possibilities. But when you sit down to write a song, do you consciously compose to that 5% of an audience, or are you free now to write effortlessly to the new audience, to the future?
Well, I have an incredible lot of freedom, but to be absolutely honest and candid with you, which I figure I must do because you seem such a decent chap.